big clap for you, man. Both the guys are, you know, struggling still. You are, you know, trying and be ready to deliver or, you know, contribute to the community. Thanks for that, and thanks for inviting me for such a good topic. So today we are going to maybe before introduction, I'll say that about the topic. We are going to see that custom connectors from scratch till end. We'll see that how to implement by using MuleSoft, you know, SDK. And about my technical expertise, I am in this IT industry from last 10 years and specific to integration domain, 6+. And if you go to more specific, 4.5 years, I'm a certified MuleSoft integration developer as well as architect. And I'm leading Coimbatore meetup, and I love to speak in the meetups on technical topics. Okay. And always ready to help people in the community. Whoever wants any help, they can reach out to my LinkedIn profile. And that's what we do, and that's what I do. Okay, yeah, that's pretty much about me. I am a IIT Bombay. So that's one more feather from my cap. So that's all.
Yep. Thanks, Asif, for the introduction. Mm-hmm. And. Yep, at the end, we are going to have a Kahoot quiz where we are going to give away the special prizes, basically the instructor-led training from the MuleSoft certified instructors. So the winner of that quiz will be getting those special trainings and as well as the Salesforce MuleSoft training vouchers as well. So please be with us till end of this session, and I'll definitely, I can assure you, you will learn a lot of things, and definitely the fun quiz is going to be very fun. And with this, without taking much time, I will hand it over to Asif so that we can start. And I've already started recording. So for all those attendees, you will definitely get the recording in the page of our events, basically.
Thanks, Amit. Thanks for that information. Few instructions for the attendees. Guys, it's not a webinar. It's a meetup. So make it interactive, two-way communication, I would say. Okay. And for the trivia quiz, few instructions. Anyway, we'll talk about that. But the people who are already, you know, won any prize, you know, trivia quiz in last 30 days, please give chance to other guys. Anyway, you won't get if you even win that trivia quiz here. So that's the one instructions you should give a chance to other guys. And if you are a MuleSoft leader, you know, or a frequent speaker, give chance, don't play that, and give chance to other guys. Yeah, thanks. Let me share my screen. Yeah, Amit, you want to add anything?
No.
Okay, let me share my screen. So actually I have two screen, guys. I'll be going here and there, so please bear with me. Let me know if you're able to see my screen.
Yes, we can see your screen.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. So let's start with the presentation. That is, we have done with this. Okay. So we go with the agenda. Okay. So today's agenda, yeah, we already spoke about the topic, but what we are going to cover in the topic, that we will talk about in the agenda. So we'll talk about what is actually a connector. And then what we have in Mule4 SDK. So we have two types, Java SDK and XML SDK. We'll see what is the difference between Mule SDK plus Mule3 Dev Kit. And then we'll see a high level overview of Java based SDK. What are the components we have in the Java based SDK? And we'll definitely talk about the best practices if you are planning to, you know, design or custom connector. What should be there and what should not be there. Okay, so do's and don'ts. Okay, those we are going to cover in the best practices. And we'll give references to the easy to go connectors. So I'll give one of my implementation where it will be very easy to understand. Anyway, that we're going to cover here also. But if you wanted to know the code and go through it, we are going to share that link in the slide itself. And then last but not the least, we'll start from the scratch and go in and as part of demo. Okay. So yeah, as I said, more interactive. So Yeah, that would be our agenda. So let's talk about what is connector. So MuleSoft follows the connectivity, and catalyst of the API-led connectivity is the reusability. Reusable, you know, and then people will, you know, production as well as the consumption. That is what the API-led connectivity in crux, if I say. Okay. So the best candidate or actor for the reusability is the connector. Okay. So there will be multiple use cases you'll encounter where you'll be having the out-of-box connector, but sometime, unfortunately, you won't get connectors. And there will be some complexity you need to. That complexity, we can make it a custom connector, and we can publish it to our organization itself. Or if you want to donate to the MuleSoft, you can donate. So if I give some examples like JSON Logger or GraphQL, you know, some connectors which people donated to the MuleSoft, or yeah, open source. Right. Even if MuleSoft is not supporting it, so because there is a big checklist. If you want, if you are planning to donate to the MuleSoft, there is a big checklist you need to. Once you check all the check marks, then only MuleSoft will be supporting that connector. All things as part of agenda we are going to cover and discuss throughout the session. Okay, so as I said, so what is connector? Okay, so basically, if I say connector, it actually brings your target system in your API, isn't it? Like, so if you have Salesforce, right? So Salesforce is sitting somewhere else in the cloud, but we can see the exposed services inside our Mule API, Mule app, right? From there only, we are not going to the and checking what else are there. Through the connector, see a small picture of the services exposed by, you know, or operation exposed by the service. So basically, connector is nothing but bringing your target system in your Mule app. And from the Mule 4, they have changed completely. Okay, so they have changed it to, you know, it's now an extension of your Mule runtime. There were a lot of challenges. So one of the challenge was like class loading. That's the challenge I could see when it comes to the connector. Okay, so that they have completely changed and mitigate that in Mule 4. How they did it? Because now everything in Mule 4 is a module. Okay, and each module has its own loader. Okay, because we know that, right? Mule 4 is so. From Mule 4 onwards, everything is extension to the Mule runtime. And how connectors are communicating with the your Mule runtime with the extension, we are going to talk about that also in the. So if you see here, MuleSoft has a range of inbuilt connectors. So we are not going to talk about the inbuilt connector today. We are going to talk about the custom connectors we are going to. So still we need to talk about the inbuilt connectors. Right? So we have SFTP, FTP. And SaaS-based connectors like Salesforce, we have AWS, Google, right? There are so many connectors. We have the MuleSoft is the top guy in providing the connector out of the box. Okay, so that's the reason he's staying there in the Gartner first quadrant, right? He's staying there in the leader. So that's all about connectors. We have connectors where you will see custom functionality like validation modules we have, right? Those are not having any configuration or connections mechanism, but it's a custom functionality where we can validate our incoming payload or responses using the validation module. So what are the mechanisms available to implement a custom thing? So there are two mechanisms available. There is Java SDK and XML SDK. So as part of this demo, we are going to cover only Java SDK because it itself will take a time. So in another session, we'll talk about the XML SDK. But what is XML SDK? We are going to cover in the session. So the Java SDK, so if you need a little complex or advanced functionality, then we generally use Java Mule SDK. And it supports both the operations, inbound as well as outbound. But in case of XML SDK, it only supports outbound operation. Okay, it doesn't support recursive call also. So let's see that. So that is the main difference between XML SDK. And XML SDK will be little different. So if I want to give example of XML SDK, so whatever when we expose our API specification to the exchange, right, we get the REST connector. All those connectors are XML, okay, XML based. And as I said, Salesforce and this SFTP, FTP, all are Java based. Okay, so yeah, that's all. So let's go to the let's talk about what is Mule SDK. Okay, so this is basically giving us the environment where we can implement our custom connector. Okay, so as I said, there are two mechanisms available, XML SDK and Java SDK. And how, as I said, this is an extension to the Mule runtime, right? So how this Mule SDK is communicating to the Mule runtime via extension API, and we'll see that how we are making use of this extension API. So this is completely annotation based. Okay, there is no code at all. You are not, I mean, when we are implementing the our custom connectors, we are not going to write any code specific to the connector. We business logic, what I want. Okay, so communicating with, you know, or defining this is operation, this is extension, this is a module, this is configuration. We just need to annotate our method or our class. That's it. Okay, so that is the biggest advantage of Mule 4 SDK. Okay, this was not there in the Mule 3 dev. Okay, so we'll talk about that also. So to hide the complexity, as I said, right, we'll talk about the use case also, in which use case generally we should go for custom connectors. Okay, so as I said, the in between our Mule runtime and the in the Mule SDK, there is an extension API, and this extension API is, you know, accessed via annotations. Okay, yeah. So let's go ahead and so let's compare little bit with the Mule 4 SDK and Mule 3 dev kit. So we don't have that dev kit in a Mule 4 now, but on the same context, this Mule SDK also fit. Okay, so as I said, we don't need to write the code specific to the communication, not even XSD schemas or something, but we'll be having annotations. We'll see what are those annotations, and we'll try to use, you know, as much as possible annotations, and I'll try to explain, okay, only single line of annotation, how it behaves, okay, and how it, you know flag your operation as an operation or parameter as a parameter, like that. Okay, so that we are going to see. And if you compare the dev kit, SDK is more powerful. Okay, so why they are seeing powerful? I was talking about class loading, right? So that is the biggest advantage I could see if we compare Mule 3 with the Mule 4. So class loading isolation is the biggest advantage, and that is there in the Mule SDK, Mule 4 SDK. Dynamic configurations, okay? And if I say more important, that is transactions. Transactions were not supported in Mule 3. Now in Mule 4, we are supporting transactions also. And the recursive calls. Recursive calls also supported in the Mule SDK. Okay, so I'll take a pause. If you have any question, then we can take it, or we'll go to the use case. Yeah, let me know if you have any questions.
See any question in the chat window, but still if people have any questions, please feel free to put into the chat. And as Ashish said, please try to make it interactive.
Yes, guys.
Yeah, so that it will be beneficial for both the parties, even the speaker and you as.
Okay. Yeah, so yeah, we'll move ahead and let's talk about the use case. Can you please repeat class loading isolation? Okay. Okay, guys, class loading isolation. Okay, it's a topic in itself. Okay, but in abstract way, I'll say that let me bring something where you can see my screen. Let me know quickly. You're able to see my screen, guys? Yeah, let me open. Okay, so let me, yeah, it won't take much time, guys. Okay. Okay, so if you see here, I'll read this. I'll read this. Okay. So let's say this is a HTTP, okay, and this is a database. So let me say HTTP, and here I both are connector, okay. In case of Mule 3, so this guy, if like this guy is depends on, let's say, I will say class 1 hyphen 1.0.0, and here this guy also, let's say, depend on class 1, but it's depending on, okay. So same class, this guy also, you know, using some functionality from the class 1, this guy also using some functionality from the class 1. But in Mule 3, we need to, so see, Mule 3 was having only one class loader. So it used to load this class 1 and class 1, okay. So there was a conflict between these two jars, okay. I can't go deep and explain you guys, okay. But I'm just giving an abstract. So there was a conflict in Mule 3. So if I wanted to, which one I should load? Class 1 or class 2? If this guy gives a priority to class 1, 1.0.0, then there is a chance that whatever functionality DP connector wanted to use, that functionality is not there here in the class 1, 1.0.0. Right? So how to handle this scenario? To handle this scenario, we need to write the complex, we need to handle it in explicitly in the Mule 3. There was no way. Okay. Now Mule 4, what they did is they have given class loader to this guy also, class loader to this guy also. The class loader loads HTTP dependencies and hide those inside. So if I go and say this guy, right? So this will be completely hidden. I'll say back. Okay. So this completely, whatever dependencies are there in the HTTP, those will be completely hidden in this context. Okay, those won't be visible to this guy. Now for this guy also, his own class loader will be loading his own jars, own dependencies. Okay, and then so what you want to expose, we have there a JSON file. That file we need to expose what artifacts or assets from this dependency of this new lab I wanted to expose to the public. So that explicitly we need to mention in that. I'll try to show you if I get a chance. So I'll show you where we need to mention that. Okay. So this will be hidden to this HTTP. This will be hidden to this context. So this, the jar conflict won't happen. Okay. So every module or artifact, there is a separate class loader. Now that is what the class loading isolation. Right. I think in less time, I've tried my best to explain. So let's go ahead. Hope you understand what exactly I'm trying to say. It's a topic in itself, guys. Okay. So let me go back to you. Any more questions? Okay.
Yeah, thanks. There is one more question. Where Abhi is asking, which one take more time in development, Java-based connector or XML-based connector?
Yeah, based on your complexity, right? So which connector you are basically, when we are implementing custom connector based on your business logic, what exactly you wanted. But XML connectors are really fast. They'll be smaller in size. Okay. Okay. Because they support less functionalities, so XML connectors will be faster. Okay. Yeah. So let's try to understand when we need, when there is a need of a custom connector. Okay, so I'll take one. This is my use case when I was working for one client, and I found this has to be a custom connector. Why? So I was implementing Mule A app. There, my requirement was to convert the currencies based on the dollars. Okay. So base value is dollar, okay, USD, and then whatever values amount I'm getting, I need to convert that. So every day dollar price is getting changed, right? So there also be, okay, let me open it quickly. Okay, meanwhile, I'll explain. So this API, this is an exchange rate API. This API used to give me a latest. I'm opening a Postman, but I'll show you that API quickly. Okay. Yeah. Let's reconnect. Hope you are able to see my screen. Okay. So this is the API I have right now. With the API key, it returns me if I fire this. You see here, today's rate. These are today's rate. Okay. You can see 15/05/2021. So the today's rate will be getting whenever you try to access this API. So this is the API. Like I say that. This is for now, it's a system API for us. So this guy will give always the latest values for the other currencies. Okay. So let's say I want to convert from dollar. So this is basis USD dollar to INR. Okay. So I need to write a logic inside my Mule app to get the value of the INR. What is the value? Okay. And get that value and then divide or multiply my amount. Okay. So to connect it to this API, get this that value, you know, parse this JSON, all that complexity I need to write everywhere whenever I need to use this kind of functionality. Okay, so that complexity I want to hide, and definitely this kind of use case will be there in your organization, right? So to avoid redundancy, I can make this use case as a connector and then share with my org, right? So that's we are going to see this use case end to end from the scratch, and this is one scenario where I could see we can implement this as a okay. So yeah, this is the one use case. Second use case where you can see here, this is the API, that API which I am trying to access, right? And that guy is pulling data from some database or somewhere else. But that is what the use case, okay? But once I get the data, I need to write a Java code here to parse that JSON which is coming from this, and then get that value and then try to get the converted value. That was my use case, okay? So I thought of making it connector. So I build it, and then as part of demo also, you're going to see that, okay? So next use case, where we have this is, I think everybody faces this kind of use case. So where I have a Mule app, and if you don't have Titanium license, right, limitation on logs, right? So you can go either 30 days or 100 MB. But fortunately, so this is a limitation. But fortunately, we have a system like Logstash or Splunk. Okay. These guys are log aggregator. They can handle your more data than 100 MB. Okay, but unfortunately, there is no connector to directly connect Splunk or Logstash. Right? Yeah. One more scenario could be to be a proprietary, let's say, backend system which can be connected via proprietary protocols only. But there is no connector available which can, has flexibility to connect to the backend. So this kind of use case are, candidate for custom connectors, I would say. Okay. So let's see the structure of the Mule 4 Java SDK module. Okay. I think we are clear with the use cases where we can go for, this is useful, right? So for logging related stuff, we'll be using in all the Mule apps. If you have this system, if you are using this system in Mule app, if you get the connector, custom connector to complexity to connecting this guy and get the data to connect to this Splunk or Logstash via custom connectors, that will be useful, right? That is what the main API led connecting. If you are building something, I think you know that. So if you don't need, don't implement. But if you need, please make it reusable, right? So don't insert there, right? Don't repeat yourself, all those things. Okay, so So maybe I'll take a pause here also if you have any questions. No, thanks. Okay, so we'll talk about So I'm sharing two screens. Okay, so here, so this is the actual structure of the Java SDK module, where you can see module. So this module is the entry point. Okay, so we are calling here module, but this is actual name is extension. Okay, so this entry point. So okay, yes, I was looking for a pointer. Okay, so this part is the entry point for your custom connector. Okay, so from here you'll get an entry, and then this is the configuration. So I'll try to show you all these parts through, you know, HTTP connector. Okay, so HTTP connector, I'll show you from where you can, you know, from where to see what. So the components, the configurations, the parameters, connection providers. Okay, so as I said, this is the entry point. From here, this is the configuration. So this is a common for complete operations or sources. So this is common for component. Okay, and then we have connection provider. So connections is again a common, you can say that shared resource here in the, you know. So we generally keep this connection pool. So I'll show you how we can build that and how we can build this connection configurations. So with the help of HTTP module, I'll try to show you. Okay, so this configuration and the connection provider, these two guys are shared resources, components, but the components, this down here, okay, don't get confused with the component word. Let's say this asset, and this asset. So configuration asset is the shared between all the components. So component can be operation, it can be sources, it can be routers, scopes, functions. I'll try to show you what is operations, what is sources, if I take the example of HTTP module, okay? And connection, where we generally test the connection, right? We pass the host, port number, and then we say test the connection. And after that, we keep that connection in the connection pool so that we don't need to create that connection again and again, because it's an expensive process, okay? Creating connection and destroying the process. Then comes the parameter part, parameter section. This is specific to operations or components, I would say. So if I'm taking HTTP, if I take the listener part, this parameter is specific to listener only. But host and port, that will come to the configuration part, right? That will be common for HTTP listeners. Okay, if I create multiple instances of HTTP listeners, those for all the listeners, this configuration will be common. But for all the listeners, this parameter will be different. So I explain that in coming. Let's go to the next slide. Now I'm taking the example of HTTP module. Okay, so if you see HTTP module in the, just a second, HTTP module, you'll see in the component section, we'll be having requester, we'll be having listener. So listener is always, you can't add listener in the operation part, right? Processing section. So this listener always goes to the source part. And requester, you can't add requester in the source section of your new application. So, but both are the part of the component. So that's the reason I said components is the collection of operations and source. Okay. There are other options also, but I took only two, requester and listeners. Okay. Now, so right side, you can see here, right? We have basic security filter, we have listener, static resource. These all four are components. But from the components, there are categories like source and operations. Okay. The routers, functions, like that. Okay. This is one example where we can categorize even components into multiple sections. Now, when you want to, you know, use or use that dependency in your Mule application, we have standard format to use that. Okay. You add the dependency generally as for automatically, but if you are using database, we need to add it explicitly. Okay. Once you drag that from the palette to your application, it will, from the from the backend, you can see configuration file got changed, and then you will see that new extra dependency added. Okay. Yeah. Now, when you see the configuration, so there are two things here. Okay. So one is the this is always unique. Okay, it's a namespace. So you see here the namespace. Why I'm explaining this? Because when you are implementing your connector, you need to take care of these things: namespace and the prefix. Okay. So here you see namespace is small case, always will be small case, HTTP. Okay. And the prefix, you see always, if you drag and drop, you see here HTTP. So this is your prefix. Okay. So namespace and prefix, there will be two things inside your, when you are planning to implement your custom thing. Okay. So keep in mind, there are components, can have multiple categories. We need to add dependency. We need to take care of the name prefix. Okay. So let's go to the XML structure of our SDK module. So in XML SDK, we'll be having one module. Inside that module, we'll be having two sections: properties and the operations. In operations, we'll be having parameters, body, and output, and error. Okay. In the Java, the error section is optional here. Okay. But still, we as part of a demo, I will try to show you where and how we can add the error section. Okay. Because that is optional. And one more thing I need to tell you here: the module here is the required thing. All other stuff is, optional. So if I want to give example, validation module, we having only module and the operations. There won't be any configuration, won't be any connection, there won't be any parameter. Okay. So module and somewhat, if you have only module, what is the point of building that connector? So that guy has to have the component. Okay. So even if you don't have configuration or connection provider, that is fine, but you need to have the required part or minimum requirement for custom connector module or any connector is the module. Okay. Hope I'm clear till here. I give example of HTTP module where I talk about the component, namespace, and prefix. Okay. I'll take a here and then we talk about the best practices. If you have any questions, please go ahead, guys.
Questions.
Okay. So yeah. So everything. I mean, even if you are building a project or something, this is not about only the connector part. So let me go to bigger screen. Yeah. So when you are planning to, build the connector, it has to be a generic. It should not be a business specific use case. Okay. It has to be generic so that people can make a reuse of it. So HTTP, if you take example of HTTP, it's a generic. It's not business specific. Okay. So always make sure that it's not business specific. Okay. So when you think this can be reusable, so this is really important, because if you're thinking it's a so definitely contention or people or trade or applications will try to access that connector in via multiple threads, right? Or even same app will try to access via multiple threads. So make it threads and try not to use the flow variables like var or name. Name is also work in our error, but it just keep it. Okay, it just keep it. It won't throw any error, but you never find why my code. Okay, so try not to rely on system variables or annotations names. If you are using annotations, right? We are saying that annotations will be tagging for your parameter and operation and connections. Okay, so don't try to use those names in your code. Okay. Avoid relying on flow variables system variables, annotations. In nutshell, we can say that don't try to use the inbuilt variable names in short. Then see on the message attributes. Try to keep it loosely coupled so that like in my case I'll be using amount variable, right? So make it a loosely coupled. So the user and then catch it in the connector section. So make it loosely coupled. Don't directly use that hash attributes dot query parameter dot. Don't do that. Okay. That is one unit. Should not use null context. Okay, so that's what I'm saying. Again, it comes to the system variables, annotations. Don't use that. And final is the option, but in my case, most recommended. Okay, so whenever we use connectors or data, you see that data sense, right? This is really if you are able to add support, then you can see once you add the Salesforce connector, say from the Salesforce, in the previous transform, you'll be able to see what kind of structures I need to build to send that information to my Salesforce operation, right? So this is optional, but I need this data sense support. So if you get this, it will be really useful to build the input request for the next activity or component. Okay, so data sense is really important. It's like for user or developer, it's very useful. So last option, but it's way I'll rate other than other best practice. Okay. So these are the references. You can go so I have categorized two lists. One is by MuleSoft and other is by not MuleSoft. So I was attending one meetup where one guy shared the Docker connector. Okay, so this is specific to document signing. Okay, so there is a cloud applications available where you can use it. And via this Docker connector, it hides the complete complexity of connecting to getting token and everything part, how to connect to the DocuSign, right? That part is completely hidden by using this Docu connector. And we have JSON Docker, right? Everybody, I mean, most of the people useful JSON Docker is, right? So you can go through these connectors. HTTP connector is there, email connector is there, and this is public repository, GitHub repository, but this is complex, okay? Hard to understand. For beginners, I would suggest go to the JSON Logger or Docker connector, or I have provided mine. Also, it's very simple. You can if you want to start, please go through these connectors, and then at the end, maybe if you comfortable, understanding the complexity hidden inside the annotations, then you can go and jump on to the HTTP connector or email connector or database connector. There are a lot, big list here. Okay, this is a publicly available. Yeah, so yeah, let's jump on to the demo part, but I'll take a pause here, guys. Okay, so Sai, okay, as you explained that Java SDK will be used for the ones which have source, and XML SDK will be used for most crowd fund operations. In tech example, Sai, I didn't say that. I said XML only supports the outbound. Java supports both the things. And if you want advanced, right, like transaction management or recursive calls, then we go for the Java. Okay, so for complex and advanced functionality, we generally prefer Java SDK. For simple functionality, where I just need to do outbound calls, so REST APIs, right? So when we are using REST APIs, those all will be outbound calls. So in that case, we use the XML. I didn't say that. Java SDK supports inbound and XML SDK support outbound. I said XML SDK supports the outbound and it will be little simple than the Java SDK. Hope that is the answer for your confusion. It's not a question. How to add the data sense supports? Is it No, we need to add the via notations inside. I have not built it as part of my demo, but there are annotations. All will be working via annotations only. So which part has to be configuration, which part has to be connection, which part is operation, which part is parameters. Everything will be via annotations. I'll show you that. Okay, Lenny. So yeah. Inbuilt, nothing is there inbuilt. Okay, but annotations are there. So we need to understand which annotation I should use for which requirement. Okay, Kalyan. So if there are no questions, I'll start with demo. Okay. So before going jump onto the demo part, I will take a different approach today. So there is already, template available. Okay, so maybe I'll share this link. It's available in the DZone. So there is a way we can create the custom connector, default custom connector, or template, we say. So there is a command here. We can copy this command and we'll get custom connectors project. Okay, but I don't want to use this. If you want to try this way, you can go ahead. I'll link this maybe in chat. I'll just copy this and paste it in the chat window. This means you can go and start exploring this way. So this is basically via template. Already template is there, MuleSoft template is there. You can run this maven command and you pass this information. Okay, so this guy implemented weather connector. So you pass this information, Anupam, and then try to build it. Okay. But today we are going to see a different approach. Okay, so that will be interesting. Okay, so this is what once you create that project, right? So you get automatically you get the files here. Okay, so you see in the Java configuration file, connection provider, extension, and operations. These files will be automatically created once you create this project via Maven command. This Maven command. Okay. And directly you can build this quickly and you can test it. It will work. Okay. So it will be having the code something like say hello world or something. Okay. Then you need to edit those files based on your requirement. Okay. So let's not do this way because it's already available. You can go ahead and try this. Today we are going to see with a different approach. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create the Mule project. And from that Mule project, we'll convert that Mule project to the custom connector project. Okay. Okay. So, and we'll go in iterations. We'll build a small functionality first. Then we'll add the functionality on top of it. We'll support the error types and then we'll try to support. So, whatever I have shown here, right? So, let me show you that slide. Yeah, this slide. So, we'll start with module and component first. Okay, then we'll start building configuration. Okay, then we'll move those configuration to the connection provider and then we'll start building the parameters. Okay, so each and every item we'll try to implement, but in iterations. Okay, so you'll get a better idea. Okay, so let me start. Hope you're able to see my screen, and this is 7.9 in Core Studio. Okay, so
yes.
I'm trying to show that also because we are on 7.9. So maybe on MacBook they need the Java 11, but in Windows we don't need Java 11. It's clearly says that it's embedded Java here. Okay, Java 8 is embedded. So let me show you. So let's try to create a simple project first. So let's try with the bare bone. Okay, so empty project. So let me give some name. So as I said, right, my requirement is, I think, let me repeat my requirement. So my requirement is this use case. And I showed you that. So this is what I'm getting. Okay. So to extract my currency value from here, I have written that Java code that is nothing to do with our connector part. Use that Java code so that we can save that time. Okay. So I'll reuse that Java code. But other stuff we'll implement from the scratch. So there is a exchange rate API that gives me latest values for the currencies, and then I need to use that in my view app. Okay, so that is what my use case. So let's go here. I say currency exchange. Based on your requirement, you can use the name. The currency exchange connector, fine. Okay. So now you see here, you can see this JDK 8 is embedded. Okay. So now 7.9 won't throw error in Windows, but in Mac I was reading logs that people are facing issues. They need a Java layer. Okay. So first thing, we have created a simple project, empty project. First thing we need to do is I'll show you where our things will be going. So first thing, we don't need this flow file. Okay, so first step, we'll delete this. So we delete the unnecessary stuff. So now I don't have any flow file here, configuration file. We'll be creating all the files inside this Java source. Okay, a resource. All the resources will be here. Before that, I need to make a little change in the form.xml. So if you guys want to follow me, you can go ahead, follow. Start your project and you can do it. So right now, this guy is Mule application. Okay. So to make it a connector project, we need to say this is an extension. First change. Okay. We need to say extension. So now this guy becomes the extension. Okay. Now I don't need this snapshot. I'll go with the proper version. So I'll say version 1.0 connector, that's fine. Company, maybe I'll say here, instead of my company, I'll say MuleSoft, group ID, I'll say, yeah, that's enough. com.MuleSoft. And the name, maybe I'll say key. Exchange. Okay, so this is, let me tell you, let me clean up. Now other than this, I don't need anything from here. Just delete it here. Okay, so now clean. Now I need one small thing, which is a parent configuration. So parent configuration we need. Okay, so I'll copy this thing. That will be coming from the parent form. Okay. I'll just try to make it. So this group ID will be org.mule.extensions. Okay. And here it will be mule-modules-parent. And for this guy, a specific version is there. We need to use that version only. So it is 1.1.3. 1.1.3. So when we are creating the, to the template command, right? Maven template command, we'll get this kind of form. Okay. Control A, Control Shift F format. And then Control S. So now you see left side of your project, everything is cleaned up. HTTP module was added, that is also removed. Socket was added, that is also removed. Clean, everything is clean. This is step one, and we are ready with the project now. Now connector project. Now as I said, we need to add our Java classes here. Okay, so I'll create a package first. Inside the package, we'll add it. So I'll say form dot connect. Okay. So I'll created a, yeah, so we are ready to start the code now. Okay, so in this package we'll try to, because in the default package it won't allow you to add any class, so that is what the reason I have. So now this is the first step. We have created simple new project. We have cleaned the clutter and we have changed the form.xml and we have converted it to a extension project. Okay, now let's start. So first thing, we'll start with our extension, which is the first item here. Okay, let me go back. I'll be jumping here and here, and this is module. So as I said, module with here technical term is module, but in custom connector it's extension. Here, let me go ahead and create a Java class. First Java class, that is. So we can't give extension as it is, so we need to add some prefix. So we'll add saying that currency change extension. Okay. Package is same. Okay, fine. Let's finish this. Now, so this is our extension. This is a starting point. Currency extension. Fine. So this is starting point. Now, just only Java file, it doesn't make any sense. So we were talking about annotations. So, and we are talking about namespace and the prefix. Okay. The first thing we need to give this class or tag this class as an extension. So here there is annotation. Now annotation start with aggregate. This is something called extension. Okay, so let me type first so that extension, and I give a name of this extension as currency extension. Okay, now we need to import this guy. So now if you see, every from the r.mule.runtime.extension, because this is a mule runtime extension. Okay, so let's select this. Now see, okay, now as I said, this is the extension name. So when we are seeing, right, when we are seeing here this HTTP, right, this is nothing but the name, that extension name, this HTTP. So now in our case we'll get a currency exchange. Okay, so that is the first thing we did. First thing we did, it we annotate this guy as extension and we give a name. That is the first thing we did. Now I give a namespace. Okay, so this namespace has to be unique. Okay, so let's go and say I'll give a name, currency-hyphen. Okay, so now control shift O, this has to be capital X. Sorry, control shift O. You'll see it's added properly. Now what I did, let me go back again here. So this part I have fixed it, this part. Okay, so this here you will get namespace with currency hyphen exchange. So my name is done, my namespace is done, because this is really important. We cannot use the existing namespace. If you try to use HTTP, it will throw error. If you try to use DB, it will throw error. Salesforce, anything. Okay, so don't, I mean, it won't allow you to use the inbuilt namespace. So please, it will be very careful when we are defining your namespace. It has to be unique. Okay, now let's go back again. So we have done, we have first part we have done is this part. We have defined this module or extension. Okay, this part is done. Now we need to define the configuration. Okay, so let me go back. Now here on top of this, we'll say that again. So this module will be connected with the configuration. So how to make that connection? Okay, that link. So here we use annotation called configurations. Okay, so be careful here. I will try to show you. So use configurations, not configuration. Okay. Yes, has to be there. Okay. Now here you need to pass which class. So all these things which we are seeing here: module, components, configurations, connection provider, parameters. These are all classes. Okay. So I need to provide the name of the configuration class. So I will say that I will copy this name and I will try to use this as a prefix for every class name. Here, my class name is currency exchange configuration. If there is a spelling mistake, guys, please remind me. Otherwise, unnecessary errors will come. Okay. So now, so our module is done. Now we need to build this class. So go here. Create this class. Okay, so we'll be going one by one. Okay, so wherever we need the class, we start building it. So I need that class in the same package. Yes, and finished. So now we got the configuration. So what is configuration here? So let me go back. Let me create a simple new project so that I can we'll say that this is a connector, right, which will be using this connector which we are going to build, right? Let me drag this guy, let me drag the listener here. So configuration is nothing but this part. So what we have here, so we have the protocol, host, and the port number. This information will be provided by the configuration. So these are the parameters, right? So we need to build this. So when you are building it, so what we need here, so if I go to my Postman, I need the host name, okay, and I need this API key. These are two parameters I need, okay. So I'll go back to the configurations. Let's close this. Close this also. Okay. Here. So we go down here, and I say that I need API URL. Okay. So this currency API URL. Okay, first I need this, and second one I need private string API currency API. Okay, so these two things I need, and I build a gateway for this. Okay, so right click, simple go to the source. And say generate getters. Yeah, I need only getters, so because I need to pull those values. Okay, that's it. Now, as I said, only simply writing a Java code won't make any sense. So we need to tag these guys. Okay, so tagging is again, it's a annotation, and it's a here. So we need to go to the org.mule runtime extension API annotations parent. Add this, then we are saying this is a parameter actually, okay. And if you see here in the here, we go to this guy. These are display names, okay. So you have decided that this is a parameter, then you need to give a display name. So you need to go back here again. This currency exchange here. So again, for that also there is a annotation, that is display name, and everything has to come from the extension. Okay. Now display name can give saying that okay. Then This is enough. Okay, you can do here placement also in which order you want. So this parameter at, you know, at which order you want, whether the first position, second position, that also you, okay, by using placement. So there is a this annotation called placement. Okay, so let's try to do that. So here you can give the placement. We'll copy this same thing for other parameter also. So I'm trying to order equal to. So at the first position, I want this parameter. Okay. Now we can give the example also. The example means example, and what value you're expecting here, right? So that suggestions kind of thing, we'll get it here. So what you want, let me copy that URL from my Postman. This is the URL we are expecting. Why is it not getting copied? Hit it. Go back. I want P here, that is okay, I'll copy that value for other guy. Let's keep it for there right now. Okay, so this is what I want in the page URL. Okay, that's enough for this parameter. Now same thing I'll copy for the other parameter. Okay, and this is the value which you're expecting here. And order has to be 2. So first I want this API URL, then second I want the API key. I'll change the display name here. Okay, and it's from here. So this is the first parameter and this is the second parameter. Now the configuration part is done. So if you go back here, this module is done, configuration is done. Now where will we be using configuration? In the operation, right? So we need to build the operation class now. The module part, entry part is done. Configuration, who will give the configuration? That part is done. Now we are going to implement the operation. So let's go back here and say operation. So we need to connect that link. So how to connect that link? Here we need to annotate this class with the operations. Okay. Operations that will come from. And now we need to say that which class. Again, I copied this as it is the exchange. And the operations dot class. Okay, that's it. So our configuration part is done. Now we'll build this class. Now go here directly and say that create this class. So one by one we are going. Okay. So now in operations, what do you want? We want one operation that that what that should do, that should take the amount and convert into a dollar. Okay, so take INR value and convert into a dollar. So let's go and build that. So before that, okay, so yeah, so we'll say that public, and I'll be expecting a return value that is double, and I'll say INR to USD. Okay, simple. And for now, what I do is I say double result equal to null, and I'll return that now. To avoid these errors first, return. Okay, so this part is done. Again, here we need to annotate this. Okay, so how to annotate that? So this guy can return. So till now, we have built the operation which does nothing. Just it returns a null. Okay. So let me annotate here. So we'll give a display name first. We'll give display name. displaying is coming from parameter, and we'll say that INR2 is has to be double quote. Okay, and media type also will define it. So for now, we say that anything. Okay, so media type, we say here value equal to this any. Okay, so comma, we say strict equal to false. So we are saying that this guy can return anything. Okay, you can return except on anything. So whatever it will return, that will be accepted. Okay. So now we need to import it any. So I'll say that yeah. So there is a way to import this guy. Just a second. Copy this. The static value, right? So we need to say here static. Media type dot here any, right? Yeah, done. So now our connector is ready. This is what we need to do with minimum, you know, stuff. One extension dot Java, one configuration, and one operation. Okay. So right now, if you see here, our method is not doing anything right now. We'll add that functionality, but this is a minimum requirement. Okay. We can directly go from here also, but we need something extra, right, to get that value from the latest exchange rate API. So that is what these guys provide, configuration. Okay, so let's go back again. So this is done, this is done, this is done. Okay, now let's go back here. Now we'll start building the, you know, functionality. So this result, right? So we need an amount. That amount has to be coming from somewhere. Okay, but we are ready with the connector right now. Okay, this is simple thing. So with these three Java files, we can make the connector. Now let me go back and now we have, we said right, this configuration will give me the values. Okay, what are those values? It will give me the API URL and the API key. So before implementing the method, I'll take a pause here. If you have any questions, guys, let me know. Where is my here? You have any questions, guys? Amit,
turn in the chat window.
Okay, guys, if you want to follow me, you can follow by these examples instead of, you know, if you want this API and API key, I can give it to you. Only part you can hard code is that, getting the actual latest value. You can hard code it and you can still implement this custom connector. Okay, I'll tell you where you can hard code that value. Instead of writing that Java code, you know, passing the JSON and then get that value. Instead of that, you can hard code simply. Today's value, you can take it and divide with your amount and it will return the converted value, equivalent to USD value of your INR. Okay. So now this guy will provide us these two values. So via these two values only, we'll be able to connect to that API and get the latest exchange rates. Okay. Let me go to the operation here. And here, so how to connect this guy back to that configuration? So here we need to say config. Okay, and that also, one second, config, this can come from the, and our class is currency exchange configurations, and we create a variable out of config. Okay, so this guy will give us the values from here. Okay, so now I build the URL. Okay, so let me build the URL. Amit, let me know the how much time we have. Okay, I think I have crossed the 1 hour almost. Okay, so how much time we have?
I think you can take your time, because we have time, and we can ask the attendees if they would like to go ahead or something else. I think we can go ahead.
Yes. Okay. So I'll start from here. So that coming iterations, maybe I'll copy paste my code so that I can save the time. But for now, here we can go ahead. Okay. So we have result. Okay. Now I'll get the config object here. From here I can get those URL value, the API key value. Okay. So let's go ahead and build that. So I go here and I'll say that, because I have one more method, so that I'll get a common variable, which is static. And I'll say, let's see, _API_URL. Okay, so this I'll bring it here. So I'll say, equal to, and that is config dot, let's say get currency API URL first, and then if you see here, go to postman, there's an extra part here, right? Latest and API key equal to, that we need to delete here. So in double quote we'll say that latest API, and then API key will be coming from the plus config part. We have and so maximize it, so it will be good. API key, I missed K here. Latest is fine. This is fine. This is fine. Now, what it will do, this I am ready with the URL now. Okay. So now, and I'll hard code my amount. Right? Double, let's say amount equal to. So right now we are not asking user to give me the amount. Okay. For now, we are hard coding it. So now what I wanted to do is I want to convert this value. Okay. With it's a result amount, okay, divided by a USD value. Okay, so I will get exchange rate. Okay, I'm creating a method, and where I'm passing that, if you see here, I'm just saying let me search here, control F. Here INR value is there. So I pass this value so that that method will give me this 73.279. Okay. So here I will just pass the INR. So for INR, I'll get the latest value. Okay. So let me create this method. So whenever I need something. So I have a code for this. Okay, as I said, I have code for this method, so I'll just copy paste that code here, and I'll explain what exactly I'm doing there. Okay. I'll just see this part only I'm using. Okay. So let's import these things with our named HTTP URL. Yes. Named URL. Yes. Everything is done. So what I'm trying to do here. Okay, so it says that's around with the try catch. Okay, so what I'm doing here is, you see this method, we are passing the currency code, and this currency API URL which we have built it here, which is coming from our config class, that we are building the HTTP URL connection here, open connection, and then we are getting that value Here if you see this guy, response, this response has this output, this complete output. Okay, this complete output is there in the response variable. And from the response variable, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to split that guy and get the value for our INR. Okay, that is what I'm doing, parsing and doing here. Okay, and then finally the exchange rate, which is coming here, that will be returned to us in this guy here. And then our 1,000 rupees will be divided by that 73.2791. Okay, today's rate. Okay, that's enough. Our connector is ready. Right now, only thing is missing is we are not accepting this value during runtime. Right now, it's a hard coded thing. So that also that comes with this. Once we implement this parameter, this guy will give us the value. Okay. So now let's go ahead. So I think we are ready with the connector. Let's go and let's see the things of first. First connector part. So now we can go ahead and build this guy. So let me go to the properties, location here. Okay. Let's run this. So MVN install. It will take some time. Everything is fine. We'll get a connector with and we'll consume that connector inside our. Yeah, so we are ready and we can use this connector. You see here 1.0 dot this one, this guy. Okay, let's go ahead and we see. You can check the your M2 repository also if you want. Go ahead and go to folder, your user M2 directory repository com dot MuleSoft. I remember properly it's currency exchange connector, and you can see here our connector is lined here. Okay, now since our connector is ready, what we will do in our consumer project, since our connector client, close this connector client, will try to use that. Okay, so how to use it? Go to form.xml and here we need to add that dependency. Okay, so let me copy this and I will edit this dependency itself. And what is this form? I'll drag this guy here a little close. Right. So what is the name of our artifact? This is the name, or we can type copy this guy. And this, okay, control shift. So now you see here we are trying to use this from our local repository, this connector. So com.MuleSoft is fine, 1.0.0 that is fine, and it's a plugin. So let me save and you'll be able to see that it's adding in the left side. Control X. Here currency exchange is added here. Okay, now let's go back to our loop and the right side. You see here, see my method is coming now, INR to USD. Let me drag it here. Okay, now model configuration. So let me go ahead and see here. We are able to see those examples. Okay, just suggestions. These are the suggestions, suggested values. Okay, now let me copy those values here and just copy those values. So this is the value URL. This is the API key. Okay. Now this guy will return me the 1,000 divided by whatever the today's USD value. So let's go ahead here and this is the path. this is default listener, this is a crashed change, that's it. And this will be written the Java output, so I just convert that into the JSON. This will be, this converted value will be coming as a Java object, so I need to convert it to a JSON. So what I'll do is I'll just see this one here, and let's see. That's it. I'm not doing anything. So I just use my method INR to UST, which we have built as part of our connector. Let's save this and let's run this. Okay, everything is fine. So meanwhile, it's running here. So I'll show you the configuration. Here, if you see, I was talking about the namespace, right? Now see what namespace we are getting. See, I got a spelling mistake here. So I keep on repeating this mistake. Okay, so you see here, we got the namespace currency exchange. The same namespace will be here currency exchange before our method. Okay, that is what the namespace, this has to be unique. Okay, second thing, if I go back, I was talking about the name, right? In the null palette, see, in the null palette I'm getting currency exchange as a name. This we have defined, it's not coming automatically. Okay, so by defining a, you know, giving a name, you need to make sure that we are giving unique names. Okay, so now since this is running, let's go ahead and it is my postman. I'm not passing any query parameter right now because it's just a, see here, it's 13.6. This is the value. If you divide, maybe if I go and in the calculator, let's see here. So if I divide 1000, you 73.27 was there, right? If I divide it, it will come exactly this one. Okay, so what we did exactly here, so we have, you see, in the consumer project, what I just passed the value, we are going to implement that also. So I just passed 1000, I based on my method. So you'll be having multiple methods here. Okay, so right now we have implemented only INR to USD, will be INR to GB, then you'll be having multiple methods here based on your requirement. Okay, and those methods will be converting your value okay, as per your requirement. Okay, that's what we did. Now let's see here what in this, we nowhere we see that we can pass the amount value. Okay, and one more thing is here, there is no option to test this connection, whether this, whatever values I'm passing, whether these values are valid or not, whether still these values are working or not working. So those things to, you know, implement in the coming iterations. Okay, so let me go quickly and pause here. If you have any questions, let me know. So just we will, yeah. Can you share the URL and the key in the chat? Okay, so yeah. Guys, don't bombard that API. You go ahead and create the key also, because if it is, let me copy that. So this is the.
Yep. So here it is basically a free API, which is currency exchange.
Yes.
Or you can just go there and then you can create your own, because there are some limits for the free APIs. So if Ashish will share and everyone are using that, there are possibilities he will get charged for that.
Yes. So you can create your.
Yep. Yeah. And then there is one question asking for the code or any step-by-step implementation for this.
Yes, step-by-step implementation or recording will be there. And if you want to see the code, my GitHub repository is there. So both the things are there. Okay, so can you once show how you imported annotation library for display name and all? Okay, so if I go back quickly, so let me say, yeah, this display name right here. So as I said, it has to be coming from the new runtime extension. Okay, so I'll just copy this and I'll paste it in chat window. Okay. Why two semicolons? I will just paste it here. This is just remove that one extra. Yeah. How to pass the default value? Can show you attention annotation. Okay, for that. Yeah. So default value. Yeah. So that is the example. Okay. So let me go to the configuration. This is example. Yeah. So example annotation, and then in the double quote you can pass those values. Okay. Any more question? Is there any advantage of using custom connector through Java SDK? Yeah. You see, again we are seeing if I already spoke about the difference between XML SDK and the Java SDK, right? So here, okay, and then going through the RAML connector. Yeah, RAML connector, you see here. As I said, the RAML connectors will be supporting the outbound calls. Okay, XML, since it's an XML connector. Java SDK we used in case of if we need advanced functionality, okay, like transactions, like recursive calls. In that case, we generally use the Java SDK. Okay, is there any guidelines for connector code testing, or we need to use a normal Java? Yeah, normal Java JUnit. Okay, so this is a completely Java project. Okay, kind of Java JUnit. Any more questions, Amit?
Yes, okay. I think we can go, and if there is any, we can take those later.
Yeah, so how much time I have now? Okay, so I think I can take 20 to 30 minutes more, and then we'll be having complete connector ready. Okay, so let me go ahead now. So what we did till here, so there are a lot of things missing here. Let me repeat those things. So if you go to this guy, see here in the configuration, if I edit this guy, in the configuration there is no testing capability to check whether this API is with this API key, whether it's reachable or not. Okay, that is one thing is missing. Second thing is I'm not passing an amount value. Somebody has to provide that. It has to be runtime, it has to be generic, right? That thing functionality is missing. Second thing is, it's not that important, but what is this? Why is this coming like this? Global elements. I don't know why it is coming like this. My perspective got changed. Okay, anyway. So, new flow. Let me drag it here. Now it will be fine. Come on. Okay, now it's coming properly. So now you see here, this is this image. You see here for HTTP there is an image, for socket there is an image, for POA there is an image, for favorite there is an image. This is a default image which what you are seeing here. So we'll try to add that image also. How to add that image? That part we'll see in iteration. Okay, so let's go ahead now. Okay, so iteration number 2. Now what we are going to add is we are going to add the parameter to pass the amount. Okay, so let's go ahead and let's start. So I will keep these guys open, but I make a space for that. Okay, so where we are hard coding that value. So if you see in this currency exchange, right? Operation. So we have added this. Okay. So now here this guy is constant. So I comment this part. Now for this guy, I need that value. Okay, so who will give that value? Now let me go to this guy. this guy will give me value. That's why I'm saying this guy will give me value, because this has to be operation specific. Okay, so inside the operation, this class has to be referred. Now we are going to create this class, and then we're going to create this class. Okay, so in first iteration, second iteration, we'll create this quickly. Let's go back. Here I'm saying that one more tag. That tag parameter groups. Parameter group. Okay, and then we'll give a name. A parameter. So if I go to this guy. Connector client and HTTP, right? See here, you are getting this connection, right? This is the actually parameter group, and inside these connections, we are getting all these three values. Okay, this is a connection. This is what the parameter group mean. Okay, so I'm trying to map. I'm not writing any unnecessary stuff, so that's what my intention. Okay, operation. Where are we? So here, name equal to, we say that input parameters. Okay. So now that is what, and then you need a class, right? So I'll try to give the values now quickly. I have steps already, so I'll try to save the time. Okay. So now currency exchange parameters, this is a class. Now we need to create this class. Okay, so this class is going to provide us the amount value. Let's go ahead and then create this class. Okay, so now whenever we need a class, we are creating it. So now this exchange parameter class will be giving us the value. So that value is nothing but, now again I'll just say here what we want. We just want the private double value. Okay, and that is amount. Okay, now I need a getter for this, because I need to get that value, right? So source getters and setters, only getters generate. That's it. Now simply writing this, it won't work, right? So how, what to do? So we need to unnote this guy. How? So say parameter, right? And that has to come from the extension. Now we can give the display name here. Let's look at it. Somebody was asking me display name, how we're passing it. So display name, and here we'll say that display name is in double quotes, that is amount. Okay, now here also we can give the, you know, optional value. Okay, you're asking the default value, right? Okay guys, default value and the example is two different thing. Okay, so example gives us the suggestion, that won't be useful. Okay, so default value, if you are not passing values, then it has to pick some default value. So that also we can do it via, there is an option called optional. Okay, this guy will pass the default value. So if you want to pass it here, you can say default value, and this is a string actually. You can say that if people are not passing the value, take this as a default value. Then you can give example also. I don't want to use that example right now. Now, if you see here, now I wanted to talk about one thing, which is expression and the static value. If you go here, sorry, not here, to the connector client in HTTP, here all these things are static values. Static values means you have to type. Okay, you can't refer something here. You can't refer something like hash attribute, right? It won't support here. See, it's saying that it won't support. So if you want to support that kind of, because my amount will be coming from my query parameter or header parameter or URI parameter, right? So that has to be supported. So there is an option. I'll talk about that. Now let me go back. So that is here. You see that again, this path is a static, I mean you have to pass the values. Okay. constant values will be here. But if you go and so just leave it here. So, so if you want to pass directly, that won't make any sense, right? You won't be able to catch those values is coming from the query paragraph. To support this as an expression, there is a annotation called expression. Okay, it will come from here. There is a value called expression support and dot support. Okay, that's it. So now this amount, instead of typing, you can write our data view expression. It will be coming from either query parameter or URI parameter or header parameter, wherever you want to pass. Okay, but now I'll show you this. Now what else? So this is done. Okay, so these values will be coming from the class called currency exchange parameters, and we don't need to annotate anything here. Okay, so now let's go back to the operation, and in operation this amount is missing, right? So who will give me the amount? This amount will be coming from param. This is the, right, the object, it is param, and param class has a get method. Let me save it. So this guy control dot with the get amount method, right? Getter there. Now this guy will give me the amount there. Okay, so that's it. Now this is, so we have added functionality to get the amount now during runtime. Now one more thing I want to add. Let me go. I want to add the image also for my character. So to add the image, okay, so there is a standard. So that file has to be .svg. Okay, and the file name has to be icon. So if I go to the, let me go here. Okay, so at the root level, maybe quick I show you. Yeah, so that file name has, you are able to see my screen, right? So that file name has to be icon dot svg. Okay, and I have dot where it matches with our requirement. So this is the icon we'll get it when we add it. Okay, so this is the image we'll get it here. So I'll add this image. Let me copy this. Copy here. I'll go to my project. At the root level, we need to create a folder called new folder with the name icon. Okay. So create this folder, and inside this folder, paste that image. So now you see this image. And when we were building, right, that time also it was throwing warning. If you see here, if you're able to see the warning, it says that icon.svg. This is standard. Okay, this was not found in the current project. So now we added that image. We have added one thing, which is the amount. Now amount will be coming from the it will be coming from the user. Okay, so let's go ahead. And now, so before that, I need to change the version. I'll change the version. I'll make it 1.0.1. Okay. So that's it. Once you save this, here, now we need to build it. So again, same command. Run this command. If everything goes fine, we get a connector version with 1.0.1. Let me check 1.0.1. Okay, now let's go back to our consumer project, and here we are using 1.0.0. now we'll change it to 1.0.1. save this. Now we'll be able to see here. See, we're able to see 1.0.1. this is the latest. Now let's go back to the Mule palette. See, actually because of this dark, we are not able to see the image, but the image got changed. Now here also you can see, here you'll be able to see. The image got changed now. Default image is replaced by this image. And now let's go to the properties now. Not listener, properties of this guy. So something went wrong. I am not able to see the amount. Message, just delete this guy, drag it again, the method. So I need to cross check why this guy is not. Oh, I have not saved this file before building the collector. Okay, I'll build it again. So, but this time I'll change the version again. Okay, so sometimes it creates a problem for me. What mistake we did, right? We have not saved that, operations.java file. And we missed it. So I'll save this. Okay, I'll build it. Okay, so now I got the 1.0.2. Let's go back. Your consumer form.xml and save. Okay, so we have 1.0.2 with proper image and everything. Let's go back to our connector and we will say that delete it and then we will add it again. Okay, now we are able to see the default value also, and this function is coming because of this, because we say this is supporting a expression. That's the reason we're able to see that. If I comment this, this will be, you know, exact like in listener we passing path value, right? Like that we'll be able to see. Here, now, this what will say? I'll say it will be coming from attribute and dot, it will be the parameter. The parameter, I will say, during runtime we are passing. Okay, so now if you see here, is that is fine. We are not changing anything here. So only one thing we are the image. Okay, now let's go ahead and run this. So where is my going here? Okay, message flow console. Yeah, it's 1.0.2. Let's go back to the postman. Now I'm passing the amount here. Okay, so let's say amount equal to 4000. Okay, send. See here, it's getting converted. So if you divide this 4000 with, you know, 73 dot something, you get 54. Okay, so now we have reached till the point where we could see our own image, we could send our amount value and it's getting converted properly. Okay, now if you see here, there are two things. So now that is missing. I don't have flexibility to test these values. Okay, that is one thing. And one more thing is, what types of errors this connector is throwing, that also we don't see here. So go to properties, error mapping, and if you see there are default. So if you want to add errors, what type of errors this connector can throw or this method can throw, those list, you know, listed down those error types here, then we can go ahead and add those also. Okay, so how much time I have? I'll find this quickly and do that. So that we have any questions, guys. If you want me to add that, I will add it quickly.
Not questions? So far.
Okay, so okay. We can go ahead, right? Or yeah, this is pretty much enough, okay. But I wanted to add few things like connector, connection provider, error types. If we have time, then I can go ahead and do that. But if you want to proceed with the trivia quiz, maybe we can. Let me.
I think we can add the button for testing the connection. That should be enough.
Okay, cool. Let's go ahead and so now we are pretty much close to that. Okay, so what I'm going to do here now. So if you see this, it's eating my space. Okay. Exchange. Yeah. So right now the configuration is providing me a API URL and the API key. And if you see my operation, this is a parameter. Actually, creating a connection and destroying key. Okay, that is what we are doing. So now for every call we are connection strength. That is creating connection and maintaining it. It's an expensive process. We are not maintaining it here. We are just creating and deleting it. Okay, destroying it. So instead of doing what we can do is we can add that connection to a pool. Okay. So let's start. So first we'll start with the operation where if you see I'll copy paste code, okay, so that I can save the time. Okay. So first we'll start with now our extension is supporting connection pool. So it will start from the this configuration, right? And operation. So where is my this guy. Okay, so this guy giving me the values. So now this guy is supporting. So there is a notation called connection providers. Okay, so let me add that connection provider. And again, naming will be same. Our currency exchange dot class. Okay. Now I want to move these parameters to the connection provider because I want to use this value there. Okay, I'll show you how to do that. But for now, let's create this. Okay, so this provider. Okay, here. Now let's go back to the connection provider. Okay, so this connection provider. It has to implement the interface called connection provider. Okay, and connection provider, let me add this and it takes the this is if you see this value is a connection provider implements the connection provider. It takes the object of type. Let me copy this connection class. Okay, now we need to create this class. Let's go ahead. So to implement connection management, we need a connection provider. And we need we can create the connection and the destroy. Okay. So now here there will be an implement methods. We'll add those methods. So you can see here the first method is a connect method, second method is a disconnect, and this validate. So this validate methods, this method will be triggered when we are we are clicking on this button. If you see here when we hit this, right, this tests the connection. When we hit this button, that validate get triggered. So that validate method needs to connect to the API and check the response from there. If the response is 200, then only it returns the test connection successful. Okay, otherwise failure. So that we need to handle it there. Okay, so let me go back. So this is what we need. So let's build one by one. So let's go first. This is save it. Okay, and as I said, so these things I need there inside my connection provider. So I can make it empty this guy. If I keep this parameter here also, then when we are going here, then you'll be able to see two sets. Not here, my connector. Here you'll be able to see two sets. One is general and one is for my connection. Okay, so I don't want to keep those general stuff here, so I delete it from there, and I'm going to add it to the connection provider. So where is my connection provider? This is connection, and here I'll add this. Okay, so control. So this format now, and then let me go to the connection, and here let me copy the code. Okay guys, so it will be quick for me. What I'm doing here, I'll try to show you. Okay, so here we have simple control shift code. Okay, so now here in this connection class, I have two methods, get connection and invalid connection, invalidate. So invalidate is nothing but a destroy the connection, and get connection is nothing but the create connection. Okay, so now if you see here, I have a constructor which takes two parameters, that is API URL and API key, and this class we are using it in the connection provider here. Okay, in connection provider, these two values will be passing to that class, and that class will be creating a connection for us. Okay, that URL, and then we'll be passing back to the connection provider. Okay, here. So now let me go ahead and add it here. Okay, so this connect method will call the, I have object called here. One by one, I just paste it. I'm calling that method, okay, that constructor, which will give me the connection, okay, from this. And the second method, I'll call it as a invalidate. Okay, invalidate will be used to destroy the connection, this to make the connection, and this validate method will be used while testing the connection. Okay, so I'll just copy this code and I'll show you. So you can hard code also here. Okay, so if you don't want to do, you want to say success, right? So you can simply say here connection result validate dot, you can say success. Okay, you get always success. This is enough. But I want to make sense, right? So I want to use these two values and then make connection to the API, check that value, whether it's equivalent to 200, the response is equivalent to 200, then only I'll send this success. Otherwise I'll send the failure. So let me copy that code so that okay. the URL connection. Okay. So now if you see here, I'm not doing anything extra. So I got the connection. Okay. And with that connection, I'm saying get connection, get response code. If that response code is 200, return success. Otherwise, return failure. And failure is says connection failed and new exception. Okay. Throws a new. That's it. And that result we are sending back to the connection button. Okay. Whatever event is getting generated from there, that event is calling this validate method. Okay. So that's enough. Okay. To get the method invalidated. Method is there. Why is it saying? Okay. Done. The URL. Okay. So we have name as currency IP URL. Okay, so to add the connection management part, we have created two classes. One is connection provider, and that is having our parameters. Okay, and what it does, it creates the connection, it deploys, and it tests the connection. Okay, simple three step. Okay, to get the connection, we are calling connection class, where it takes the API key and the API URL, and it's a connection and it's close the connection. So this class has two responsibilities, one to create the connection and one to destroy the connection. Okay. So that's it. Okay. So let me go back here. Control S. Error. What is that error? Currency exchange. Where is this error? I could see there. Okay, I think extra. Remove extra. Yeah, so that's it. So what we have done, let me recap quickly. So from here, we have deleted those configurations. If I keep those, what will happen? We'll get a two sets in there, in the test connection window. Okay, so let's save this also. Now here, now this instead of, now configuration is not giving us the values. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll create here, we'll get those values from the connection provider. Okay, so let me copy that now quickly. Now these values, we don't need to make connection here because we have delegated that operation or responsibility. Okay, so let me add this or import this. So now this connection, we don't need this part. So what we are going to do is, what is not needed, so we are not going to build any connection here. So for this method where we are building the connection and making a call, I'm just passing directly the connection object. So I will say that change the method and add the parameter. Yes, so I added that connection here. Okay, connection 2, and here if you see connection in this stuff, right? I don't need this part. Say that here, these two things you don't need because this is already done by this. And this has to be true because it's coming from here, hit the connection. And yeah, let me make it this picture. Okay, it's done. So from operation, we have removed the configuration because these guys added now connection part. So the connection management is done by Mule runtime now, okay, not by our method. Okay, so the connection management, keeping in the pool, everything will be taken care by Mule runtime. So the changes which we have done is, let me save this. So changes we made it to the, let me maximize it. So to the method, so in method we are not creating any connection or deleting any connection. So that part we are given to the connection here. This guy has the responsibility to create the connection and invalidate. Okay, the disconnect. Now we have connection provider. Let me save this. This guy has two parameters, the API key and API URL. And whenever it wants the connection, it just call that constructor. And whenever it wants to disconnect, it calls the invalidate method. And whenever somebody is testing the connection, it uses the validate method. Okay. So let's save this. I have not added the error types now. Let's go with this option itself. And now let me change the version first. So this is 1.2.3 now. Let's save this. If everything goes fine, we'll be able to get the option to test the connection. So then we have 1.0.3. Let me go in my consumer form.xml and make it 1.0.3. Save it. And now if I see here, I got 1.0.3. And if I go back to my here, so I'll just say there is a problem. I delete this because we have removed something and we have added something. So let's go there and I'll drag and drop method again. Now let's see. So my amount is as it is. If I edit this guy, see here, now we're getting the option of test connection. Okay, so let's copy those values. Okay, my URL, control C, control A, control B, and my API key, control C, control B. If I test the connection, test the connection successfully. Okay, so this means I can see during design time itself, I can say that, okay, these credentials are correct. Okay. So now on top of this, you can add the protocol here and say that HTTPS, HTTP, that is with the help of value provider, you can make use of it. Okay. So I think we are running out of time. Maybe let's say, okay. And global event is fine. If I say save, so we have added that part. Let me check if it is okay. So yeah, so we have removed something, right? So let me go back. This is a line number 9 configuration, line number 9. In the configuration now, we don't have these two parameters. Okay, so currency API URL, it's moved to the connection. If I delete this, perfectly fine. Because see here, now it goes to the connection. It's no more, you know, available in the config. Okay. So yeah. So if I save this now, the issue, the error will come. Okay. Yeah. Error is gone. Console is clean. It's clean here. Last round, we just change the amount to 5000. Send. So it's taking the value from, okay. 1000, right? Because default value is taking, they have not changed that value. Here, if you see, it has to be attributes dot query runs dot amount. Okay, save this, and I don't need to build that because in consumer only I'm changing. Okay, so done. Let's go final round 68. Okay, if I go back to the 1000 here, 13 rupees. Okay, $13 actually. Okay, yeah, so that's all from my side. Amit, it's over to you, and I take a pause here, guys. If you want to add error types, then we can do that also. That I already shared in the GitHub. You can go ahead and refer that. We so time because we don't have time much. But I already written the 2 hours, I guess. Yeah, Amit, over to you. If you have any questions, I'm open for the questions now.
Thanks, Ashish. First of all, yeah, it was really great to see, because it has been already 2 hours we are in the call, and from 2 hours we are implementing. So it was really good to see, and I'm sure the audience have learned a lot. There is one thing, one question from Dheeraj is asking what kind of protocols are supported or not supported in the connection development, and do we need consent from third party API provider in this case exchange rate API provider?
See, exchange rate API provider, they itself given the once you subscribe to that API, you'll be able to see what protocols are supported by that guy. Okay, and once you get the license, right, you'll be having that license, that how many APIs are so definitely we need to know that. We need to tell third party, yes, I am subscribing your API, and so that's definitely.
Yep. So there is one question from Hari Lal. He is asking, can you show how to add data sense support connector? So Hira, basically, yeah, we are out of time. Otherwise, we could have shown us. And my battery is also about to die, and there is no electricity from last 2 days from in my hometown. So that's hard for me as well. Hope you will understand this.
Yeah, Hiralal, we will be having maybe another session where I can show XML and the error types, how to add and do data sense. Yeah,
we can definitely have a continuation of this session if everyone likes. And then there is one question who's saying from Pawan, who's asking, could you please tell any example or scenario for inbound scenarios where XML SDK can't be used?
Inbound scenarios.
Yeah.
Yes. No, it only supports the outbound. So why we are, I mean it won't support inbound at all.
Okay, and then Shiva has answered to Dheeraj. Thank you, Shiva. And I won't take much time because it's already been 2 hours, and thank you for being such an amazing audience here. So I'll quickly share my screen so that we can start the Kahoot quiz.
Yes.
And so basically there will be 5 questions which you all need to answer, and then after those quiz we will get our 3 winners. I think you need to stop sharing your screen because I'm not able to.
Okay.
Yep.
Now I can start my
video. Yep, sure. So I've just started sharing my screen. Please do let me know if it is visible. Yep. So basically, guys, I think most of you are already aware about this platform. So what you all need to do is, if you have a mobile application, open your Kahoot application and then put this pin. If you don't have a mobile application, you can go to visit this www.kahoot.it and then put this game pin. And as soon as you will put the game pin, it will ask your nickname. So I'll say try to put your name and try to put a name which is making a sense, because sometimes we have seen audience are putting the game pin, so you don't need to put that game pin. And I will put this over here in the chat window so that you can find that game pin.
No Chintu, no Mintu, okay? Actual XYZ ABC.
Yep. And thanks, Ravi. And we are glad you like the session. So we will see the name over here as we have 30 audience. So to assist, because we have audience like 33 at the starting of the session, and everyone was eager to learn. And we are, I think, the same number of audience at the end of the session.
Thank you so much.
Yep. So we've got 18, 19, 20. So I can see there are 20. Yes, go ahead, Asis.
I have one more session, 2 o'clock.
It is, I think we have eaten so much time here.
No, it is needed actually, okay? So step by step, you know, you go iteration by iteration, people will understand.
Yep. We've got 23. Anyone else is joining or anyone having problem, please do let us know on the chat. Okay, so we will wait for 15 seconds and then I'll log the quiz and then we'll start. So let's log the quiz and start. Okay, 3, 2, 1. So it is like kind of faster finger post. DevKit is available in Real 4. Connect true or false. So we've got false, okay, 13 correct, 10 wrong. Who is in the top? Kalyani, and then Harshad, Avin, Harshal, Hiralal, Abhi. Next question. Which SDK to build, used to build Salesforce Connector? I think we are expecting almost everyone to give the correct answer. We have talked so much about the SDKs. 20. Okay, we have got Java SDK, XML both. So basically, we have used Java here. We haven't used SDK for this development. So that's why the correct answer is Java. Okay, now we have got Afin, Hiralal, Kalyani. So all three are on the top. There is. Okay. Number 3 out of 5, which Mule version connector supports transaction? Mule 3, Mule 4, Mule 5, Mule 33. Mule 4, that's true. So basically there is only one wrong answer and everyone was listening very careful. How's the leaderboard is looks like? Abhi is here, Hiralal is also here. So we've got last 2 questions. Which operations is or supported by XML SDK? So we've already talked about, and I think the last question was also related to the same. So inbound operation. So only two people were able to get a correct answer. I'd love to see. Okay, so we've got Harshad who has got the all four answers correct. Then we've got Abin. So last question, and we'll see who are there in the top three leaderboards. Okay, all connectors are supported. Supporting class loading isolation in Mule 4. Three, two, one. So the answer is true. And then 18 people got it correct. So we'll see who is at the podium. Number three, Abin, congratulations. Then we have got 5 out of 5, Chandra, congratulations, and Harshad. So congratulations everyone for winning a training voucher here. And to win, like to get your voucher, what you need to do is just go to meetup.mulesoft.com and then is that, yep, and then / Faridabad. So you will go over here in this link, scroll down to the bottom, click on contact the organizer, just put your name, put your email, and in the message say that you are one of the winner of the trivia quiz, and give the session name, and then send it to us. So I or Pankaj, anyone will be connecting you further for this, how you are going to get those training vouchers. And one important thing is that while sending the contact here, you need to use the email which you have used while signing up for MuleSoft training account. If you have not training account, please go ahead, sign up again, and sign up, and then use that email to send us, because now MuleSoft is sending the vouchers directly. So you need to make sure that the email is correct over here. And with this, we have come to end of our session. Again, thank you, Ashish, for this wonderful session. And guys, please fill out the feedback, because which is very important. And we can say feedback is like food for us, the speaker and the organizer. Tell us the next event that you wanted to have, basically the topic on which you wanted to have the next event. And also, if you wanted to be a speaker over here, you can again go to the same link, contact the organizer, and then you can tell us a speaker in the next event, give us the brief about your topic, what topic you would like to speak, and we will definitely would love to host. And with this, thank you, and thanks everyone. Thank you for giving us your time over the weekend.
Thank you, guys.
Yep. So if there is anything